Good morning, EBC. Let's all stand together and worship the Lord. In Psalm chapter 100, it says, "Make a joyful shout to the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before the presence, his presence, with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us and not ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful to him and bless his name, for the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures forever." Amen? All right, let's sing. Let's worship the Lord. Come now fast.
Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise a mountain upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise mine Ebenezer, hither by thy help I'm come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus, to grace how great a debtor, daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy grace, Lord, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above.
Thank you, Jesus. You may be seated.
Well, good morning, everyone. How are we doing this morning? Great. Do you guys see what's behind me? Oh, I meant the musicians. No, oh, that was good. That was good. I appreciate that. No, we got the shirts on. You're seeing those around. You're going to be introduced to BBS. That is this coming week. And so you have probably walked through the halls and seen the transformation in different areas of our preparing for this coming week. And we are excited about what we desire for the Lord to do. We are here as his vessel, hopefully this week, and hopefully you are participating in some way. We just got done in our life group talking about how the Spirit has gifted each one of us differently, and that means we all function differently. I am not the crafts guy. It's not me. We would make those same glue stars every night that I just know you squeeze the glue, you stick all the toothpicks, and you put the sprinkles on top, and you call it good. That's about all I know, and I could somehow spin it every night to the story, somehow, because that's what I do. I talk, and so I could come, there's a beeline to Jesus in every star somehow, but everybody's a little different, and I am excited to watch. It is one of the greatest blessings when we get around to that week, and I see people in their wheelhouses doing what they love, serving Jesus and making him known through the ways that God has gifted them and talented them and passioned them. And so I pray that you're a part of it. If you're not participating physically on site, man, I pray and I want to challenge you to be praying. Because we do not just want to build a house, we want the Lord to build the house. So as we labor, we're laboring for him and by his power and with his results. And so please be praying for everything that is going on over the next week as we minister to families, as we minister to one another and love one another in serving together, as we pour the gospel into these kids, opportunities that we have to impact lives where people just bring their kids and drop them off. And we get to be able to share Jesus and make connections. So please be praying as we prepare. I have heard word that please don't send any more goldfish. We have enough goldfish for the next 2 years. And don't worry, the expiration date is like 2027, so you'll see them. But we, if you wanted to bring something, just the Chips Ahoy or the fudge stripes are the two that they could use more of. So those are the two that they'll take. Please, no goldfish. All right, beyond that, there is a training after church for those that are involved in that training. Make sure that you're there. There's lunch for that. Pastor Eric, Ms. Kelly are going to be working in those areas to train people and get them ready. And so if you have a question, if you haven't signed up yet, all those things, this is kind of your day to get those things done, to get ready, to find your place, and to get your kids signed up, your neighbors signed up, your neighbor's neighbors signed up, ready for this week ahead. There are a couple things that are coming up. First, today is the final day to sign up for the ladies' retreat that's coming up in November. Women, you're thinking ahead. So it's November, but they need that registration to know kind of where they are. I think we're sitting at like 27, 28 ladies at this point. If you want to be a part of that, there's only like 32-ish spots, so get in quickly. They'll make some changes, and you can see her if you have any questions. It was perfectly timed, sweetheart. Well done. And speaking of that lovely lady, at our house beginning next week, the women's book study is going to be starting. You need to make sure you get your book and have read chapters 1 and 2 because you're going to hit the ground running. That starts next Sunday night, and you can talk to Melissa about that as well. I will throw in one more, and Mike Turner, raise your hand. Mike is coordinating a whitewater rafting trip down to Tennessee second weekend in September, the 9th and 10th, that weekend. If you are interested in going, men, on that trip, you can see him for details. He's kind of reached out to some people through Facebook connections and that, but if you haven't heard about it, that's the man to talk to. He would love to hook you up. I think you're supposed to be signing up real soon, too, for that. So you need to find him after service and learn more about it. He can tell you about it, but I would love to have you as a part of that trip heading down to Tennessee in early September. So talk to him today. A deadline is tomorrow, unless there's space available. There's always that caveat, unless space is available. All right, something coming up, not this week, because it's VBS, but the next Wednesday night, we have this new family and this young man who is now leading us in worship, the Cantwell family. They spent some time on the mission field, and before going to the mission field, they got rid of all their stuff, just gave it away to people, and now they have an apartment, and then they need stuff. Not a lot of stuff, and specific stuff, and strategic stuff, because it's an apartment. But what we're going to do as a church to welcome them to our EBC staff and as a part of our family, we're going to have an ice cream fellowship on the 27th. That's not this Wednesday night, but the next Wednesday night. and we're going to pound them. Now, I remember when I was told that I was going to get pounded, I thought, oh, I have not been here that long. Please don't hurt me yet. Eric has informed me what a pounding is. It's like you give him a pound of this or a pound of that. I had no clue. I just thought I was being pounded with love, hopefully, and not fists. But the way that we're challenging our congregation to give is to help them kind of get some of those items that they need for a home. And so IKEA, Amazon, Target are the three places that they're kind of zeroing in to make some of those home purchases. And so if you would be so inclined and so stirred in your spirit to bless them with a gift card to one of those places, you can do that sooner than the 27th if you can't be there on the 27th. But if you can be there on the 27th, we're going to eat ice cream even as we celebrate pounding them. We'll put pounds on ourselves. So it'd be great. Keeping with the theme. All right. And then finally, one other announcement. That is deacon nominations. Last week, you heard from our chair of deacons, Adam Townsend, as he shared kind of the desire of the deacon body in reaching out to the congregation, looking at that scripture passage of the congregation nominating and raising up those men that they see God putting a calling on their lives to serve in that unique position as deacon. You were challenged to pray for who you might recommend and nominate. And so we are receiving those. And so that's in the bulletin again this week. If God has put a name on your heart, make sure that you submit that name and maybe a direction of where you see them serving. They don't necessarily have to serve in that role, but if they're encouraged and said, man, I see you serving in X, Y, or Z, that would be an encouragement to them. Well, we are glad that you are here. If you are visiting with us, we're glad that you have chosen to be here. Every person in this room, to some degree, chose to be here today. And at the same time, I know there's a sovereign God who orders our steps and brings us here today. And so those two things are working in conjunction for us to meet with him, to worship. Prone to wander, prone to leave the God I love. And then our prayer, here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above. That's what we come together to be reminded of in a world of all the chaos and all the things that are going on, all the distractions, to come into this place and say, man, Lord, it's so easy for me to be torn this way and that way. Center me today in this place, worshiping you, lifting my voices and my gifts and my talents along with everyone around me by your power to your glory. Will you pray with me? Father, as we are in this place to worship, I pray that you would give us the grace to do just that. God, give us the space to be able to worship you freely in our spirits, in our bodies, in our minds, in our hearts, with our words, with our attention. That all the things that we bring into this place, being gifted by you to have any of those things, may we submit all of those things to you today for you to work and will your good pleasure. That today would be a day where your name is lifted up and that we are reminded of truth and we are warmed again to the things that we know from your word. I pray that you would help us to meet with you, to celebrate being your kids because of the work completed on the cross by your son, Jesus. Thank you that we have a message not only to proclaim to the world, but to pour over ourselves each and every day. The grace for each day, the mercy for each day. God, today may you supply what is needed that you might get the attention. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Would you all please stand together? Deep the fire.
trust in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know. My ransom. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my
so good. God, with every breath.
Most of you know who this lady is. This is Miss Paula Long. Paula has had the blessing and challenge of caring for a mom who is in declining health. And so we don't get to see Miss Paula very often in service. This is her second time since September of last year that she has gotten to be with us. But I have asked her to make those arrangements to be here this morning because she plays a pivotal role in VBS. She is one of those persons that goes around and has those conversations with kiddos about the gospel as they have been hearing about that message and they've expressed some interest in that message. And if you know anything about her, she loves Jesus with an intensity and desires that kids know this Jesus and love this Jesus with the same or greater intensity. And so she is going to lead us in a time of prayer as we prepare for VBS.
Okay. As Pastor BJ said, I volunteer in Vacation Bible School. I'm a gospel team volunteer. And we meet, as he said, with children who in the course of VBS indicate that they think they want to know more about Jesus or that they're ready to make a profession of faith. I love VBS. It is such an awesome place to be. I'm an alumna of VBS. I went there as a child a few years ago. I grew up there. I'm still growing up there. I'm a veteran, and so I'm enthused. I'm invested, and every year I get to watch these kids come in. They get out of their cars, and it's interesting because they run and they skip to check in. It's really fun to watch. They run and skip, and then when they leave that night, they're equally joyful and enthusiastic, and I'm pity their parents when they get home because I'm sure it's like this and they've just had some sugar and life's good. But as volunteers, no matter the assignment that we have, we're investing in the lives of these children who need to know Jesus. And for some, VBS may be the only time that they're ever going to be at church. And for others, it may be a week of learning just more and more and more about Jesus, who he is and why he matters to them. And they do it in fun ways. So either of those options are great. We don't really care. It just presents us with an opportunity to tell them more and more and more about Jesus. It's actually one of the most important things that we can do this summer. We do it for the families, and we do it for our community and the surrounding areas. And because that's a fact, I'm going to ask you today to be specific as we pray for this next week. I'm going to ask you to pray where you are or in small groups. So if you want to gather together, that would be great. And I'm going to ask you to pray for VBS leadership and our worship teams, for VBS teachers and all of our volunteers, that the children will feel loved, encouraged, and valued, that the parents of the children will be receptive to what their children learn, that each child will come to know Jesus in a closer way, and for those who are ready, that they will be willing to make a profession of faith in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. So if you'll gather together in small groups or if you'll pray where you're seated now for this week of VBS in this community. Father God, we love you. There's none like you. You can do all things. Thank you for this community. Thank you for this church in this community and the mission opportunities that we have. We are so grateful for the opportunity to share the gospel through VBS. We ask you to be with each volunteer serving in our Vacation Bible School. Give them all they need to express the love of Jesus to those in attendance. No matter the age, Lord, we pray for ears to listen and hear your truths, whether that's through lessons, music, or play. We pray for the minds to understand and to be open to those truths, and we pray for hearts that will welcome Christ as Savior. We pray that the efforts made in our VBS will help parents, families, and children feel closer to you and loved by you, that it will touch and change their hearts to those who need you most. We ask for your blessing on this year's VBS as we seek to do your will and nurture the spiritual growth of these dear children and their families. Lord, make a difference in the lives of these children and their families through your church, this church. In Jesus' name, amen.
I think you might remember me. You used to know me well before you were introduced to fear and doubt. I was with you on the cold, dark day when you were all alone and you thought that things would never turn around. It was me that moved the mountain that was standing in your way. I believe you want me back, so I will wait. My name is Faith. My name is Faith. I noticed you've been looking at the stars up in the sky. You're searching for a light to guide you home. You think you need a reason just to trust a simple prayer. I am here when you think I might be gone. I am the companion of the happiness you'll find, and I promise I am always ever close. My name is Hope. My name is Hope. And if you listen carefully, you'll know just where we are. Carrying the promises that heaven's not so far away. I'm the one who speaks the loudest. I'm the keeper of them all. I was born before the world was ever here. I am everywhere and everything you'll ever need to know. I'm the passion in your laughter and your tears. I'm the healer of the broken, the forgiver of your soul. And I'm ready to ascend just like a dove. Well, my name is love. My name is love. We are the voices that still whisper in your heart. And if you listen carefully, you'll know just where we are. Carrying the promises that heaven's not so far away. My name is Faith. My name is Hope. My name is Love.
If you have your Bibles, we are going to actually dive into Psalm 139, from which our theme for Vacation Bible School is actually found. Psalm 139 is one of those passages that you may know well, but is very very important for us to keep in mind. there's a lot of things that we're going to kind of pull out today, and I hope that with fresh eyes, you are encouraged in the faith and in the love of God and in the presence of God for us. I am a science nut. I enjoy science. I loved astronomy in college. I took the astronomy classes that I could take so that I could learn about outer space. It's always intrigued me. And so this past week, were you glued just as I was? The new Webb telescope? Okay, I'm getting a couple. Thank you. Thank you. Relate with me, brother. Thank you. Amen. So I think about looking up at those stars, and there is this new telescope that has been built. It was a $10 billion telescope that was built. It sits roughly 1 million miles above Earth's surface, orbiting the Earth. It is actually outside, further than the moon is from us, taking pictures and sending them back to Earth. And this picture was the first one that was released to us this week, and it is like one little microscopic like dot in the sky where it basically focused all of its energies and just received all of the light coming from that area and gave us a glimpse into a universe that is spectacular. These were the first of many beautiful images that have been promised to be released. They give us indication of seeing all kinds of things. And the way they will describe us, they say, well, you get to see back millions of years because it's taken that light that long. As an aside, if God makes a rock, it looks old when he makes it. And so I'm pretty sure that when the Lord stretched out the stars, he made sure there was light to be able to see it already across the galaxies and universe. He did that for a reason. Says in Genesis chapter 1, he gave us the stars also. He gave us the sun and the moon for our seasons. This picture of the world and of our universe has God as a designer and a purposeful God. But I want you to imagine the feelings for just a moment if you were not someone who believed in God. You look at that picture for just a moment and you realize that there are millions of galaxies, trillions of stars, unknown numbers of planets. And here we sit, as the old TV show says, on that third rock from the sun. And man, there's got to be questions that come to your mind. Like, what am I? What is my purpose? Why am I? Who am I? What significance do I have? Can you ever have purpose outside of yourself without a divine creator? At the movies, you go and you can observe Marvel's fascination with the multiverse. And there are universes, and lots of them. And they are all happening simultaneously. There are timelines that are even more complex than ours, than the one we got a glimpse of. They're supposing that there may be millions and billions of those. Those universes even have what-if scenarios. There was a released set of shorts where it asked the question, what if this had happened in that movie instead of that happening in that timeline? You ever been there in your own life and gone, man, what if I had crossed the street that one time? Or what if I had gone through that door? Or what if I had run that light? Or what if I, X, Y, or Z? And we kind of have all of these timelines that we can create. And there's a fascination with understanding maybe all of those things. And for some, they've posited that all of those are actually just as legitimate as the one that we're currently experiencing, because they're experiencing theirs just as real as we're experiencing ours. And it kind of starts blowing our mind, and we start asking these questions. What is real? And are we real? We live in a culture and a world and where the value of human life and the significance of human life is constantly under fire, right? In the courts, just this past month, Roe v. Wade was overturned. And we have a discussion now that has been brought once again front and central with maybe one of the strongest lights upon it that it's ever had in decades. where this decision has now taken it and removed it from a national conversation to a state-level conversation. What is the value of that baby inside? Does it have inherent worth, or is its worth and value determined and defined first by the one who carries it? And the question isn't settled. We still have a conversation happening at the state level. Depending on what state you're in, there's a different answer. For us who believe in God, the question has completely been settled for all time, forevermore. And now we have the opportunity to continue to be in that conversation with our nation. In our politics, gender identity has thrown great confusion at even our youngest in our culture. We can no longer define what a woman is or a man is. We have confused kids, tossing them to and fro by a culture that seems to have lost its way. It's the blind leading the blind. It's a social experiment of the worst kind, aimed at helping people validate who they are, but instead baffling our youth and promoting actions which have tremendous and sometimes irreputable consequences that we don't yet fathom. Enter into this moment of VBS where we get to say, you're made with a purpose, and you're made for a purpose. This morning, I want to take a moment and help us remember what is at stake as hundreds of kids will show up to play games, sing songs, make crafts, and hear stories. They are coming, maybe having lived in the throes of everything that I've just mentioned. The voices that they hear at home, the voices that they hear at school or through media are sending messages that are so counter-gospel that coming here and hearing this may be one of the first times in their lives that they hear clearly a different message. And so if we have our place in Psalm 139, would you stand? Let's read this passage and we're going to break it down together. Psalm 139, O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You understand my thoughts from afar. You scrutinize my path and my lying down and are intimately acquainted with all my ways. Even before as a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it all. You have enclosed me behind and before. You've laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is too high. I cannot obtain it. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you're there. If I make my bed in Sheol, behold, you are there. If I take the wings of the dawn and if I dwell in the remotest part of the sea, even there your hand will lead me and your right hand will lay hold of me. If I say, surely the darkness will overwhelm me and the light around me will be night. Even the darkness is not dark to you and the night is as bright as the day. Darkness and light are the same to you. And you formed my inward parts. You wove me in my mother's womb. I give thanks to you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, and my soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the deep, in the depths of the earth. Your eyes have seen my unformed substance, and in your book were all written the days that were ordained for me when as yet there was not one of them. How precious also are your thoughts to me, O God. How vast the sum of them. If I should count them, they would outnumber the sand. When I awake, I'm still with you. Oh, that you would slay the wicked, O God. Depart from me, therefore, men of bloodshed, for they speak against you wickedly. Your enemies take your name in vain. Do I not hate those who you hate, O Lord? And do I not loathe those who rise up against you? I hate them with the utmost hatred. They become my enemies. Search me, O God. Know my heart. Try me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there's any hurtful way in me. And lead me in the everlasting way. Will you pray with me? Father, I ask that you would speak to us and give us truth. And once again, ignite our hearts to the message that is so vital to the hope that we have to offer our community and our kids, our families that are hearing this gospel. May the truth ring out boldly through your people. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Made for a purpose, Psalm 139. take apart this passage and just kind of give you some things that I see here that remind us of the importance of what we are about to do. The first thing I want you to see is this: made for a purpose. God knows us completely. Knows us completely. First six verses, you've searched me and you know me. When you look at the web images of the vastness of the universe, it is easy to think that you are but the speck on the top of a needle in a forest filled with millions of evergreens. It is very easy to get lost really fast when you try to contemplate the scope and magnitude of the images that you are seeing. I have shared this before, but I will go to the Creation Museum and I'll sit in that planetarium. And like every time, and I've watched this thing before, and so the next time I gear up even better the next time to say, okay, I'm going to hang in there a little longer this time. And they start doing these orders of magnitudes of these moons and stars and all these things. And I'm like, okay, I'm with them. Like, for example, I mean, it takes a million Earths to fit in one sun. And we have like a podunk little average sun. And so then you're like, okay, I've got the sun, I've seen it, I know what that's like. And then you start being compared to these other suns. And like you get Betelgeuse, you're like, I mean, you start losing the ability to even comprehend. They start talking about the distances across it, and you, about two-thirds of the way, I'm so frustrated because they've lost me, because I can't fathom it, and I'm just humored by my God who says, I made it that big so that you would understand that there is no way that you can search the depths and the riches of who I am. But man, without God, you look at all that and you go, then why do I even matter? What is the purpose of all of this? And yet what the psalmist comes back and says is that the creator of all things knows you. Like, is that not an amazing thing? He doesn't just know of you, but he actually knows you intimately, even your thoughts. Talk about that for a contrast. I mean, it's a spin back to Psalm 8, where he says, when I think of the heavens and all of those things, what is man that you're even mindful of me? And yet he is. Please hear me today. Do you struggle with your value and worth, with your significance or your importance? Know this morning that the God of the universe knows you and is with you. Do you struggle with depression, sitting quietly at home? Know that God knows. Are you losing a battle to sin? God knows. Are you wrestling with illness or a malady that's threatening to upend your life? God knows. Are you fighting for a relationship, or are you fighting in a relationship and it's tearing your heart apart? God knows. Are you walking through life numb because of all the world's junk? God knows. And he offers himself. Look at those next verses. God made you for a purpose because God is with us. Verses 7 through 12. Where can I go? The psalmist says, you know me. Where can I go to flee from your presence and not be known by you? It's an incredible thought that after knowing us even better than we know ourselves, that God still actually wants to be with us. Have you ever wanted to run as far away as you can from yourself because you're sick and tired of you? You're tired of the thoughts, the challenges, the frustrations, and you only know the half of it. You don't even know all the stuff that you don't know. And if you knew those, you'd be even more repulsed. And yet God knows every bit of it. And he says, I'm with you. And when it's quiet at night, and the dust has settled, the stars are out, the moon sits in the sky. I often think about the peace of that moment. But man, those are also the moments where things like that, you go, man, I am so alone. No one knows what I'm going through right now. And yet, here in Psalm 139, we are reminded again that we are never alone. As far as we have run, wherever we go, There is no place and there is no time where and when God is not with us. I shared this illustration before, but I think of hide and seek. You know what you watch a kid play hide and seek with his dad. You know what that kid wants to do? That kid wants to be found. He does not want to ultimately hide forever from his daddy. The joy is hiding and then being found by his dad and being caught up in his dad's arms. In fact, you'll hear this because you'll hear the kid snickering or, "I'm over here." And you're like, "Dude, you do not know how to play this game." But they know exactly what they're doing. They're infatuated with a father who is pursuing them. And they want to be found, ultimately. If you've ever been in that game where you hid so well that everybody gave up and just went on in and started eating popcorn and quit, you're like, all right then. It's not a badge of honor. It's more of a, does anybody care that you left me out there? Did anybody do a head count? Were you just going to leave me in the dryer the entire time? Why didn't you look there for me? We have a God who knows us and who searches us out because he wants to be with us. He is with us everywhere. Why? Because he has designed us intentionally. Verse 13 through verse 16. You are created by God. He created your inmost being. He knit you together. In verse 14, it says, I praise you because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful, and I know it full well. I think about the human body. It is extraordinary what God has made. You think about those two little girls, Layla and Louise, as we wait for them to come home. Like, when you have a one-pound baby that doesn't even make, like, how do you have fingerprints on that thing? It's amazing the way that God has knit together this body. It's so intricate, so profoundly elaborate in its detail, even to the smallest of levels. But I want you to hear something in the midst of this. As David writes this, he recognizes God's handiwork. But I want you to catch the second half of the verse. Because he not only recognizes what God has done, but he says it is wonderful. Hear the words. David is saying, I know you made me and your work in me is wonderful. You see, it's not an abstract thing here for David. It's not, man, humanity and the way you made everything in the design, it's so cool, it's whatever. It's God looking at the unique creation of himself and saying, God, you've made me. And it's wonderful. So many of us struggle with our worth, our value, our esteem. And yet David is proclaiming, this is who I am, and it is wonderful because you have made me. When you look in the mirror, can you say, God, what you've made is wonderful? Or do you find everything wrong, beat it all up? God has made you. He's knit you together. And the psalmist, who is a man after God's own heart, looks at it and says, thank you, and I praise you. David is valuable. David is special. In his creation, David understands that he was created and designed intentionally by God, who chose to make him and to make him for a reason. I pray this week that the kids that come here know that full well, that they know all of those people that have been made in every facet of it, that they would see their existence is wonderful, that they have value, significance, beauty. Doesn't matter what you look like. Doesn't matter the things with which you struggle. You've been put together for a purpose for God. You need not change that. Their worth is grounded in their Maker. And he has fulfilled his desire in making them. Notice this verse is in the present tense. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. It's not when I was cute, when I was a baby, but now, woo! No. Who we are now includes right now who we are. I wish our kids would be able to know that their rising and their laying down also is not just of today. Because he goes on to say, I made you and I know all of your days. God knows the moment of our conception and he knows the moment of death's reception. He knows not only our first moments in the womb, but he knows every day that we will ever live before us, any come to pass. He knows the number of days my grandkids will live and their grandkids will live if he tarries. This is a God who has designed on purpose. Every one of you in this room have been designed and made for a purpose. And God has put you in the body, and for many of you, in Christ, because you've received Christ as your Savior, he's recreated you in Christ, and he's made you into a spiritual family, and he's given you gifts and abilities that are a part of this body. Made for a purpose. Next part, verse 17. We are known and loved by God. How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of the sand. When I awake, I'm still with you. This is amazing. Our God loves us. For God so loved the world that he, even when we rejected him, pursued us in Christ. His attention and his energy have been freely used by him to form, sustain, and engage his creation. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. The thought of God thinking about David made David's heart sing. He was a kid found by his father who had not stopped searching until he was found. I want you to think about these truths for just a second. It is an incredible thing that God has made us. Just think about this. Stop for just a second and think. It is an incredible thing that God has made us. He did not need to make us. He did not need to make the universe. But that is what he chose to do. He chose to make us. And then he chose to make us in his image so that we could relate to him. Understand, he made all kinds of animals, but he only made one in his image that he would be able to relate with them in a way that was personal and meaningful. This means, then, that we have purpose and value to him. And even more, it means that purpose in life is found in relationship with him. That's why he made you, to be in relationship with you. Like he did not need any of it. And so he freely chose to create you, which means his desire was to bless you and to be in your life and to give you an opportunity to be in relationship with him. Like, that's what it means to have creation, is that he has created us for relationship. That means outside of that purpose, regardless of how noble the task or the cause is that you take up, you will always fall short of the ultimate reason that you exist unless you are in relationship with him. Because that's why he made you. He didn't make you for an ends that you would, whatever you might do, build something, grow that, do this, do that. Those are means. The end is relationship. This is eternal life, Jesus says in John 17, that they may know you and the Son that you have sent. I made you to know you. That's your purpose. And that means as we go through this week ahead, we're inviting kids to know their Maker because he made them to know him. And he has made a way through Jesus Christ that they can be brought into that relationship and experience that to a depth that they have never maybe known before. These are incredible things that are here in Psalm 139, but I want you to catch how it ends. Because as you're reading through this, it's like all the warm fuzzies. And then you get to the end. Oh, that you would slay the wicked. I loathe those who loathe you. See if there's any wicked way in me, Lord. Search my heart. Did you not just read what you wrote? I want you to take this seriously. Last thing I want you to see is this. We must reject everything that is set against God. The tension between loving God above all else means so much more in our culture and in our time for us to be clear with our message. You might think these words of David are offensive, but maybe we don't esteem his love for us and our value that he has given us enough to see it more black and white like he does. You see, there is definitely a battle for our hearts and our minds. There is a counter narrative that goes against everything God tells us through his word. And the question is this: do we despise it enough to give ourselves to the defense and the proclamation of the gospel? Are we zealous for the cause of Christ and the work of the kingdom in bringing purpose, significance, value, and hope to everyone the Lord will bring upon our path? This is huge. This is looking at the glory of God and saying, I despise all things that fall short. And this week, we're going to have people that come to this campus and get to hear that we are proclaiming a message, not ourselves, not this church, but Jesus Christ. Because he is worthy, because he has made a way for us to know who we are supposed to be, that we were made for a purpose. And so, what an incredible gift you have this week, that they're coming, that you might invite them, and they're going to get to hear that they're not random. They're not here by chance. They aren't just here to live and die. They're here to know and be known by a God who has made them and has put up all of the splendor so that we can see the splendor of him. I hope that gets you excited. You get to be the vessel of the greatest message ever known. We get to proclaim this God. And so we are the hands, we are the feet, we are the heart, we are the voice of God this week, calling these kids to know their Creator. So here are some VBS reminders. First one, we got to make sure that they know they're not a mistake. They're not a mistake, they're not chance, they're not a slip up, they're not anything. God opens the womb and closes the womb. God put them here. God wants them. They are loved by God. They may not know what love truly is, even in their homes or in their schools or in their wherever. But they are loved and they have been pursued by this God. They have a purpose. They have worth that is transcending what someone says about them. They have an identity that is wrapped up in the one who made them. God has made a way for them in Christ that they would know him and know this purpose for which they have been created. And the reality is, at the end of the day, everyone around them also needs to know. And we need to continue to challenge them, not just to be hearers, but to then go out and tell their mom and tell their dad, hey, you go tell your mom she's made by God, she's loved. Then tell her to come talk to me. God has given us resources. God has given us his spirit. God has given us gifts. God has given us this week. And so, to help you remember, much like a child's pastor here, I need you to know you are not to be selfish with your lives this week. But give them away, for God is worthy. Will you pray with me? Father, I thank you. I thank you for the proclamation that we have to give, for the message of hope and life and love, for the message of you, a message that is so desperately needed because it seems to be so quickly crowded out, cast aside. And yet it is the one message that stands true forever. For you were there before time began, and you are there at the end. You are the one who declares the end from the beginning. You are the one and only God who through you all things came into being. You needed nothing, and yet you chose to make us. And then in our rejection, you chose to pursue us still. I thank you for the lofty, unbelievable, unfathomable gift of grace. And the message of the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. That you're not done. That you have purpose for us. And it's found in you. Lord, I pray for us here as we consider once again the opportunity that we have to respond even in here to that message. That you would help us to see that our lives, that our purpose is wrapped up in you. And if we have not given ourselves over to that, that we would surrender today and see ourselves in light of who you have said we are and made us to be. Your creation, called to be in relationship with you. And Father, I ask that as we have thought about these things again, that in the face of a culture that says so many other things, that this week we would be so bold as to love boldly, to share the message clearly, to be used by you in the gentle nudgings of the conversations and the words that we are to say. I pray for favor and grace in the eyes of our community. I pray that you would bind the enemy from the distractions of those who might not come, and instead just say, they would just open their doors and say, you know what, we're going up there. God, would you meet us? Would you work through us to share the gospel? It's worthy of all acceptance. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I want to invite you to stand as we have a time of closing. It's a time where you can continue to pray for what God is doing in your own life. Maybe there's something in the message that you need to just to be reminded of who you are and what God is doing in you and through you. And maybe you just need to spend some time saying, Lord, I have listened to the world long enough in this, and I need to lay that at your feet and entrust myself to you. I want to challenge you to do that. If there's something that is that you're dealing with and the Lord knows, and you just need to lay it figuratively down before him, maybe you come and you just spend some time in prayer. There's something I can pray for you about. I would love to do that. And there's a time where you want to talk after service. I'm available. You need to respond this morning. No. We all need to respond. However you need to do it, would you do that as we sing?
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals, he's waiting and watching, watching for you.
God who's always welcoming us in that song. And I pray that that's exactly what you find in your Savior And that's exactly what you declare out loud.
Good evening. Welcome to WZUM News. My name is Ezekiel. Today, we are on location at Woolloongabba, Australia. Top news stories of the day. Local pastor dresses in a lobster suit for VBS sermon. Tells congregation not to be shellfish. This week at VBS, we will be traveling to Australia exploring some of the lesser known cities such as Fowl Bay, Woolloomooloo, Nowhere Else, Wagga Wagga, and Moobal. Each day of VBS, we will be exploring in our creature feature five amazing animals that our Creator God has made. This summer's VBS is set in the land down under, and we are focusing on the value of life and that each of us is made for a purpose. In other news, did you know that a baby has more bones than a grown adult? How does this happen, you ask? Well, don't worry. There aren't any bone deposits left in diapers. What actually happens is that the bones fuse together to make lesser bones. Our Fair Dinkum verse for today, Fair Dinkum is an Aussie term which means 100% genuine and truthful, is Psalm 139:14. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. And now, for a word from our sponsor. Welcome to Will It Blend? I am working on opening a milk and lolly bar in Australia called Zeke's Smoothies that specializes in unique smoothies made for a purpose. Today's smoothie is going to have milk, strawberries, crackers, and a Swiss cake roll. And we're going to call it the Swedish Chef. All right, now let's add the Swiss cake roll, one of my favorite parts, and the strawberries, and of course, the oyster crackers. And then we can't go wrong with a little milk. All right, now let's seal it up. And blend. All right, I think it is successfully blended. So let's pour it in the cup. Oh, look at that. Swedish Chef. Here we go. Not quite the crunch I was expecting, but sure is smooth on the throat. Would you try a Swedish Chef? Zeke out.
The Western Desert, hot and dry.
The Western Desert, hot and dry.
The barren land, the cloudless sky. Jesus makes the desert blue.
Jesus makes the desert blue.
Living water for me and you.
Living water for me and you.
Me and you.
Zoomeray, zoomeree. Yeah, God made you and God made me. Zoomeray, zoomeroo. All of the old and young ones too. And near or far, no matter who you are. Zoomeray, zoomeree. Hey, we're all one family.
Why don't we all stand up and do this together? Why not? Come on.
So everybody everywhere,
everybody everywhere,
come along, no time to spare,
come along, no time to spare.
This crazy world has gone astray,
this crazy world has gone astray.
Jesus is the only way,
Jesus is the only way.
Ready?
Zoomeray, zoomeree. Yeah, God made you and God made me. Zoomeray, zoomeroo. All of the old and young ones too. And near or far, no matter who you are.
Join us this week. Have a great day. Be praying. We'll see you soon.